Dit is Pelican House in Church Hanbrough. Church Hanbrough is een plaatsje in de buurt van Oxford. En daar woont Reverend O'Hanlon, die door velen genoemd is de grootste reisliterator van na de oorlog. Hij heeft nu 2 boeken gepubliceerd die alle 2 in het Nederlands vertaald zijn. En ik ben er niet weinig trots op dat ik een tijdje geleden bevriend met hem ben geraakt. Hij heeft mij beloofd een aantal Engelse collega's, schrijvers uit te nodigen. En daar verschrikkelijk mee te gaan drinken en eten, wat hij altijd doet. Maar wij zijn wat eerder om rond te kijken naar zijn plannen en in zijn huis. En zijn plannen voor de toekomst, daar zal hij ongetwijfeld alles over vertellen.
Hallo.
How are you? You're jet lagged and tired.
And thank you for your beautiful presence. I was very
wonderful to see you.
Nice to
see you.
What? Look at this new smart cake you've got.
Yes, and Buddy Holly.
Buddy Holly.
Redmond O'Hanlon werd geboren in 1947 en debuteerde zo'n 6 jaar geleden met een reisboek over Borneo. Daarna schreef hij een 2e boek over een reis in Zuid-Amerika. En zijn boeken vallen zeer op, niet alleen door hun mooie literaire stijl, maar ook door de grote hoeveelheid informatie die ze geven. O'Hanlon is gek op informatie. Hij woont in een huis dat vol staat met boeken over vogels, met schedels, met rare dingetjes. Het is wat men met recht zou kunnen noemen een hele excentrieke Engelsman.
Reverend, 11 months ago, I was here for the first time. And I was very amused with your room here. A little bit full.
And I now remember you coming distinctly. I thought it was Mick Jagger at the door.
Yeah. But there are more books now and more dead animals or not? The situation is the same.
Well, since I've seen your library, I've added a few books, but not really. Not Badwin sort of books. Africa books. Preparing to go to the
most
Congo.
Most of the books are bird books, if I see well, isn't it?
Bird books are 19th century travel books. That's what I like.
And that's your life, birds and travel.
Yes, and mammals, and sleeping, and
drinking.
That's the problem.
But about birds, what's your fascination, especially with birds?
Oh, it's a deep childhood fascination. When I was 4½, a missel thrush flew over me and dropped a little eggshell I'd been cleaning out its nest right in front of me. And I didn't know the cosmos was an empty place and the universe was indifferent. And I thought this eggshell was just for me, so I made a collection of birds' eggs. And so it's a sort of pre-intellectual pleasure, and it keeps me going on these rivers. This is the missel thrush egg. I kept it ever since. That's what started me when I was 4 years old.
4 years? You kept it 37 years.
Yeah, I believe in them.
Yeah, I don't believe it.
Stability.
It's really true.
Yeah, yes. That story's true. And this is the great crested grebe egg that I'd collected. See, it's covered in sort of reed residue. I collected on Bowood Lake, it's called, near Cairn, where I grew up in a English vicarage. And Blenheim Lake reminds me of Bowood.
What are you doing with these eggs? You look every week one time to the eggs?
Yes, I'm afraid they inspire me. They look for... yes, all my childhood's there.
Where are rare birds here in the neighborhood?
Oh, there's a lake nearby that Duke of Marlborough owns. He lets us go and look at it. And it's very like the lake that I went to when I was a child.
It's possible to go now to the lake?
Yes, we can go now. Why not?
Emiel, hoi.
Ja.
Emil, jij hebt Redmond ontdekt voor Nederland.
Ja.
Mag ik het zo zeggen?
Ja.
Hoe kwam dat? Je zag zijn boek in het Engels?
Nee, ik kende zijn... De man met wie hij naar Borneo is gegaan, de dichter James Fenton.
Dat was zijn eerste boek, hè? Into the Heart of Borneo.
Ja. En de broer van James Fenton, die kende ik goed. En die had een kleine uitgeverij. En die heeft het boek van Redmond uitgebracht. Die heeft het mij een manuscript laten lezen en gezegd... Dit boek is zo ontzettend goed, kijk daar snel naar. En ik vond het ook zo ontzettend goed. Dus voordat het op de markt kwam in Engeland, kon ik het al kopen. Voor Nederland.
En wat boeit jou zo? Want je bent zelf vogelaar.
Nou, het is bij Redmond de combinatie van enorme kennis van het gebied waar hij naartoe gaat... en het enthousiasme van een jongensboek. He, zijn helden zijn de 19e-eeuwse reisschrijvers zoals Wallace. En daar heeft hij veel mee gemeen in de zin dat hij precies weet wat hij aan dieren te zien krijgt. Hij weet er alles van. Tegelijkertijd heeft hij dat krankzinnige enthousiasme.
We're talking about you. He's saying...
Is he saying nice things?
Yes, he's saying very nice things. Yes. He said, you are... as enthusiastic as a little boy. Is that true?
Well, certainly in this sort of place. It just reminds me of being taken out in my father's canoe, sitting in the front, and he'd paddle, and we'd take one egg from a grebe's nest and raid a mallard and look about. And he really thought that the spots on a butterfly's wing were put there by God for our delight.
What are you seeing?
Just mallard and tufted duck. And there's one teal over there.
Wat zijn?
Een taling, wilde eenden, kuifeenden. En dat is het wel een beetje.
What's so special about the birds here?
Sometimes migrants put down here. I mean, you can find
and they come
birds,
from...
but it doesn't have to be a special bird to give one pleasure, really. I like looking at tufted ducks, rounded like a buttock.
I know you also know the bird life in the Oostvaardersplassen.
Yes, Emil takes me there. It's wonderful. Go to Amsterdam and out onto the polders.
And what about
spoonbills?
Polders. What's so special about the bird life in the Oostvaardersplassen?
Oh, well, it's incredibly rich for an Englishman. Just can't believe it.
This lake and the castle, that's a castle or a hall?
Well, no, great house. It was given to Duke of Marlborough after his victories, and Blenheim was the biggest one, so it's named Blenheim Park.
And is now living a duke, the ninth or the tenth or the 11th?
Yes, he lives in that wing there.
And it is 250 years old, I think.
Yes,
200 perhaps. And it's a gift.
And it was a gift to him, yes, for his services on the battlefield. The swashbuckling duke. But he was a great general.
Reverend, you are training now for your leaving for the Congo in 5 months.
5 months' time. You can say I've got a long way to go.
But where first at training?
Well, you need to be as a ghastly moment when you get out of your canoe and you realize you've got to walk with people who are incredibly fit and they spent a lifetime doing this. And you've got 60 pounds on your back. And in South America, little Yanomami Indian just went whoom, underneath all the foliage and the trees and you have to keep up with them.
And
that's a terrible moment, so it's worth having 5 months of pain every morning, as you can see, after drinking all night.
But do you know the difference between the Amazon and the Congo? Is there a difference in landscape and in difficulties?
It should be a flat or flattish swampland. 700 miles by 500 in the Congo. Rather different from the wonderful country we were in the Amazon.
And what are you looking for there in the Congo? What's so special?
Well, I'm really going to see a different set of birds. I've never been to Africa, but I mean, the story is that I'm going to walk south for 4 months. And indeed, that's what we'll do through this swamp. The pygmies know the high ground through it, apparently. And at the end there we should come to a big lake. And in this lake there is no monster. There's meant to be a prehistoric sauropod there. Lots of pygmy reports, but I think it's a pygmy joke probably. It's called Mokelia Mbembe.
Mokelia Mbembe.
But it might just as well be called Mbadwin Mbuki, as far as I can know.
And why have you chosen the Congo? Why not the Kalahari Desert? Or?
Oh, I like big, fertile, wet, hot, female areas. I like to get into a river and go up the inside of the leg of the land, up towards the center.
And what's so special about you, you're always reading a lot about the region you're going to.
Yes, I think that's, you must acknowledge your predecessors, and you read with tremendous speed. It's quite unlike academic reading. I only found out last week that bedbugs carry AIDS for 1 hour in a little blood reservoir. So I'm going to take a stopwatch. Never get into a bed that a pygmy's been in, or anybody else has been in, till an hour and 10 minutes have elapsed, I thought.
But are you homesick when you're there?
Well, the first week's bad, but then I think that I'm perfectly all right. But then I have a recurring dream. And it's very simple, but I come back to Heathrow, to London, and there's nobody waiting for me, and that's all right. And I get a taxi, and I go home, and it's very dark. And I knock on the door of the little house, and then there's a long wait, and eventually it opens. And there's this enormous man, and he leans down, and he says to me, "Son, you don't live here no more." And then I wake up, covered in sweat, incredibly anxious. Yes, and it happens every 2 weeks, about.
Er is hier een hele vreemde collectie in huis met beenderen en schedels van opgezette beesten. En Redmond, you are collecting a lot of strange things.
Well, badger skulls from badgers I've stuffed myself, and foxes and so on. But there are serious sort of fetish objects, but objects that remind myself and some of my friends not to do certain things. I had a great friend at school, my closest friend really. And he was a depressive, but eventually he couldn't bear himself any longer. I'd been secretly reading his diaries, and he was saying, "My penis grows uglier every day." You see, and I'd read this without him knowing, and I found there's no way in which I could comfort him about it. And one day I said, "Well, I mean, everybody thinks that they're ugly at some time in their lives, or they get miserable." And he wanted to be a great painter, and it was very difficult for him. And he was studying medicine, and things wouldn't go right. And then he got on his big motorbike and he went to Holland Park and he scraped up a pile of leaves and he poured petrol on it and he burnt himself to death. And then after that, letters arrived for me which he'd post-dated, telling me where to pick up a trunk and where he was going to do this thing. And so Belinda and I went to Holland Park and the body had been removed, in fact, by a park warden who'd been in Ceylon before that, who'd come from Ceylon because he couldn't bear seeing all the Buddhists immolate themselves. This was in the very early 70s. And there on the ground, about where his foot would have been, lying on this pile of leaves, were shards of flesh. And I collected them, and there they are.
There's the foot of your friend?
Yes. And I've got lots of other empty coffee jars. And all my friends know that. And nobody else has killed themselves.
But I think it's a little bit bizarre to have.
Well, perhaps it is, but it
what's that?
Seems sensible to me. Oh, you open that. You'll be the first time on Dutch television that a very rare fish has ever been seen. Now, this was one of my great fears in the Amazon, and I talked about it on a television show, and two fish scientists were watching it, and they didn't believe my story. And the story is that if you swim in the Amazon rivers and you take a pee as you're swimming, that little fish, it's called the toothpick fish, the candiru, it sniffs the stream of urine and it swims up it straight into the penis, and it puts six spines out on either side and does a half turn and hangs in there, and the tissues are so damaged and your urethra's blocked, bladder swells up, and if you don't cut off your penis, you die. You have to get to hospital quickly. And nobody believed it, but these fish scientists put nets across the river and they found those fish everywhere.
You removed this fish from your...
No, not in fact. No, it was sent to me. Because it was thought to be a mythological fish. But you see, that's actually a pregnant female, but you can see it would fit precisely
into
the penis. Yes, it's in formalin. It's dead. But before I went to the Amazon, I thought I'd fool it. And this is my protective device. You have to admit this is a work of genius. It's a cricket box with a tea strainer on the front.
Oh, you can do so?
And you... That's right. Well. You just step into it. But when I showed the Indians, they just roared with laughter. And they said that only an Englishman would do such a thing.
And that's protection enough?
Yeah, well, it's not obviously not big enough for you, because you're so well hung. But that's
actually...
Not
for the little holes in it here. Oh, no. It feels fine.
Does it?
Yes.
No, it's too small for you. You're such a hell of a guy. You and Mick Jagger, you just can't fit. You need a bigger size.
You have a special fascination with weaponry and military things. Why is that? You were never in the army.
No, it's disgraceful, isn't it? I can't help it. It goes back to childhood. I used to do a lot of shooting of pheasants and rabbits and so on in the farms round the vicarage. It was the only way I could escape from vicarage life. The mother's union would be coming to have a tea party, and I'd shoot out of the drawing room window, get on my little motorbike and go up to the farms, which were all run by church wardens, and I could walk about and shoot rabbits. I didn't hit much, but it meant that I could watch the birds with an excuse. But there was more than that. I'll show you a dirty secret from childhood down here. I would love to have driven a tank. And I tried very hard in the cadet force at school at Marlborough, but I couldn't find the battlefield on my map reference. I looked everywhere. And then I took my men in the platoon to a transport cafe, and I was caught having double eggs, chips and beans by the sergeant major with all my platoon. And I was court-martialed and thrown out of the cadet force. Had to join
and
the forestry.
And that was the end of your military career?
Well, it was, I'm afraid, but you see, I compensated ever after.
What's that?
And you mustn't tell Ian McEwan, but I would like to drive a tank. Well, I never have. See, these are 1950s, but I'm afraid the terrible secret is that's bought in 1988.
You're now also buying tanks in your 40s?
I'm afraid so, yes. Well, these are wonderful solido tanks from France. But these are the old English dinky toys. Rather wonderful.
These are original.
That's a Centurion, yeah.
And we're here now in your study.
Yes.
But how it's possible to work here?
Well, I work there. There's the most wonderful view.
Here?
The window. Yeah, I work there. But perhaps it's why it took me 3 years to write the book.
All right, now what's this here?
Oh, that's my notebook. Oh, that's the most dangerous thing in the Amazon basin. If you're not killed by the Yanomami, that's Rhodnius prolixus. And
it's after a beetle, or?
I crawled into the Yanomami Shibono. A great. Ah, the tanks. The tanks have fallen down.
It's
I crawled through the hole into a Yanomami Shibono. We finally found these people I'd been looking for. And I looked up and saw that their penises were tied with string. And they had 8-foot-long arrows pointing at me. And I thought, how wonderful, these are the genuine people. And then I thought, my God, they're going to kill me. And then, in fact, of course they didn't, but I was beaten up by an old woman. And I thought, this is wonderful, I'm completely unaffected by all this. And I sat down, and I reached up to my neck, and a little tickling on my neck. And I pulled this off, and I recognized it at once as Rhodnius prolixus.
But what kind of insect?
It's an assassin bug, and it carries something called Chagas disease, which gives you a disease for which there's no cure, like AIDS. And you begin to die from 1 year to 20 years later from a degeneration of the heart, and there's nothing can be done. And I said to my Indian companion, tell me, has it bitten me? See, and it happened, but it bites you. And then the trypanosome in its brain, it makes it turn around and it shits on the bite. And when you scratch the bite, you rub the parasite into your bloodstream, and then you've had it. This is the end of you.
And this is your original notebook from the Amazon travel?
Yes, I clapped it into this. And then that's me worrying about money here.
Money in the Amazon?
Money, yes, wondering if I had enough to pay these people. It cost me £15,000, the whole thing.
I really don't understand it.
The Yanomami understand it. Their main drug is administered through a 4-foot-long tube. And I wondered why, when I watched people taking it, they smack their hands on the back of their head as if their head is coming off in agony. And I wondered why. And then when I took it,
my Indians
said to me, don't take it, it damages the brain. And I thought somebody had to take it, and they beckoned me across the Shibono. And I sat down, and the chief took three pepper pots full of this stuff called yopo, and he flicks it into the tube. It's a 4-foot-long tube, and he puts it into your nostril, gives a tremendous blow, and then you think your head's coming off, and it's incredible pain. The whole ear, nose, and throat system goes into shock.
Not hallucinating, or?
Well, your lungs then fill with grit, and you can't breathe for a fraction of a second.
But what's the kick then?
Well,
what's
he puts kick? It in the other nostril, and that's the pain is indescribable. I've never had such pain. And then suddenly the sinuses open, and the snot pours down your face, and then you're incredibly sick. You absolutely throw up your guts. And then suddenly the pain goes, and you sit there thinking, I'm alive, I'm not in pain. And that's the most wonderful feeling. I think that's what the excitement is.
Strange drug.
Yeah, you're no longer in pain. And maybe that's a bit like travel writing. I mean, the whole business of it. The excitement when it's all over.
Reverend, you are now in an antiquarian bookshop in which place?
Well, this is Weldon Wesley. I always come here before a trip. I've just been looking at a jaguar killing a tapir, and we were lucky enough to eat a tapir, but we never saw a jaguar. Maybe in the Congo Republic, I'll be lucky enough to see a leopard. This wonderful book here. Look, in the accompanying plates, I have given representations of the two styles which exist among the animals generally known as leopards.
And do you have books with you when you are traveling?
Yes, lots and lots of paperbacks.
paperbacks.
It's essential to have books which have nothing to do with the area you're in. If I'd known, I would have taken double the number to South America. My photographer, I think he partly went mad and was yelling into 6 million square kilometers of jungle. Where's my tomato ketchup? He was shouting. It was shaking all over. He was went to pieces. I think if I'd had more paperbacks, it might not have happened. He ran out of books. He ran out of cigarettes. And I think that's when he began to collapse.
Your house is filled up with books, a lot of books. What's so special for you, these books? I can tell my love for books. Your love?
Partly I go traveling in order to justify building up my library. It's the truth of the matter. It's a wonderful excuse to buy all the 19th century books about Africa.
One of your most beloved books is Smithy's The Birds of Borneo.
Yes.
Tell me a story about the book.
Well, it's very heavy, and so there's always the decision to be made of whether to put Smithy's in my pack or not. And I thought I ought to leave it behind in a longhouse before we began the long walk to the central mountains. And I thought that one of the Kenya might steal it, or anyway. So I took it in my pack all the way there. And it was my only reading, really. And brought it back to England. It's wonderful. I covered it in tape to keep the wet off it. But it has bloodstains in lots of places, just from leeches getting on your hands. But they actually sniff at you from the bushes, and they can last about 10 years without a drink, so they're incredibly hungry. And as you sit down, you think the whole jungle floor's moving, and you realize it's these little leeches moving from sucker to sucker.
Edwin Brook.
Hi, nice to meet you. Hi, nice to see you. My entire family here.
Emil Brugman.
Hello. Hi. Hi.
Can we get drunk?
Can we get drunk?
We'll rescue the family.
Well, I should show you this while we're here. You know that in England there is we had this campaign against drugs.
Mm-hmm.
About 2 years ago, and there was a badge called "Just Say No to Drugs," and now there is this other badge which is called "Just Say No to Redzi."
What's Redzi?
Redzi is Redmond. And this is in case he asks anyone to go up the Amazon with him. They had to wear this badge, and it says, "Just Say No to Redzi." And in fact, I bought this in Covent Garden. They're now on sale. He's so notorious for this, asking people to do impossible things, that he's gone up the Amazon. I just thought I'd tell you that.
Redmond O'Hanlon is in heel Engeland, en vooral ook in de society pers, bekend om zijn diners waar gegeten wordt en vooral gedronken. Aanwezig waren deze keer de dichter Greg Raine, die van één poëziebundel wel 20.000 exemplaren verkoopt, Galen Strawson, filosoof, maar bekender als criticus bij de Observer, en natuurlijk was daar de romanschrijver Ian McEwan.
Ian.
It's Ian.
Man,
it's a Scottish one. Like the Rhodesian Prime Minister.
That's right, yeah. Ian Smith.
Have you ever lived in Amsterdam? Is that true or is that...
No, I'm just an occasional visitor. But I'm very impressed myself.
And you visit a literary bar, I've heard.
That's right. I'm taken by Jacob Groot and Elizabeth Groot to
That is your publisher.
My publisher, De Harmony, to Hopi's bar.
Hopper.
Hopper. And I've always been impressed by this institution.
I've heard
people
of it.
Sitting around, and, very unpretentiously. So when you say this connection of writers seems unusual...
For us, for me, yeah.
Yeah, I think actually...
you know, plays
in Amsterdam, that they do it very well.
And when's that?
Well, should we say this on television when it is? Well, it might get rather crowded.
Lots of writers will be there.
Yeah, everyone's invited, 11 o'clock every Sunday morning.
I know the bar, but... and who are there then? Which people?
This is really good.
Now there you really... Who have I met? I've met Jan Donkers there. This is some years ago. And I've met Dirk Kooijman there.
Dirk Eyold Kooijman, yeah.
I think once I was there with Freek Jonge. Surely
That's
one
enough.
Of the greatest Dutchmen, isn't he?
Sees Notenboom?
No. Oh, yeah, I saw him there. I think we were... He was doing a signing in the Athenaeum.
In the bookshop? On the other side of
But that would be a natural bar for writers, because it would take the overspill of people going to shop in the Athenaeum.
But is there any bar in Oxford for writers?
There aren't bars in this country.
We don't have bars, no.
A place called Munchy, a wonderful Indonesian.
It has no license.
It has no license. It's completely teetotal. You can take a bottle in if you want. But mostly what we do is we go there and eat.
And we try and keep sober. And the idea is we work in the afternoon. But I go home and sleep anyways.
Is it possible as a poet to earn money enough? I don't think so.
Christ, he's got a Mercedes.
No, nothing.
No?
Mercedes.
I have a Mercedes. I don't drive a Mercedes car.
There's much blame maybe with my cars in England. And how I have this huge royalties. Because people look at my cars, but in fact my cars are always bought for me by my mother-in-law.
But you can't earn money with your books. Mm. How do you earn money? Working at university.
Yeah, that's right. I've just got a job after many years of trying.
But why writing books on philosophy and you sell 77 copies?
I didn't. One wouldn't do it if one wanted to do it to get money.
No.
It couldn't be a motive.
But it's a good thing. Everybody can read your book and won't read your book. It seems to me a little bit frustrating when nobody buys your book.
Yeah, it's frustrating that it costs nearly £30. So you know that very few people will be able to buy it.
And Ian, you wrote a lot of novels. Could you tell something about a new novel?
I'll tell you very little, because I'm superstitious about that.
Yes?
It's set in Berlin in 1955.
20 years after Isherwood. It's in the Cold War. It's a Cold War novel,
sort of.
And that's all you can tell about it.
Yeah.
And when it's finished,
then I'll speak to you about it.
Ponderous stage directors and the good guys put it all in the text.
Gentlemen, I've done a little research on Redmond.
Terrific.
And could you give a opinion in 1 or 2 minutes about this strange travel writer? Ian, you're first.
Oh, shit. Yeah. I think I'll chew this piece of meat and think while I'm
going to say. Emiel, wat vond jij nou? Jij ontdekte dat boek voor Nederland. Wat vond jij nou zo speciaal?
Nou, het speciale aan Redmond vind ik dat hij het levende voorbeeld is van het feit dat je niet volwassen hoeft te worden als je dat niet wil. En als je hem je hoeft maar een half uur bij hem te zijn en de gekste dingen gebeuren. Dingen die gebeuren in kinderboeken, jongensboeken. En ik herinner me van een jaar of 2 geleden dat ik hier was. Ik werd natuurlijk binnengehaald met glazen whisky. En ik was 1 minuut binnen. De buurman komt en zegt... Het spijt me, er is hier... kan je me helpen? Want er is naast ons is er ingebroken. En de deur staat open. En er moeten inbrekers zijn. Normale reactie is dan om de politie te bellen. Redmond springt op en zegt... Eindelijk kan ik wat met een geweer doen. Haalt een geweer. Haalt ook een revolver en een groot mes. En neemt mij mee naar de buren. Waar we de deur intrappen. En zoals je dat op film ziet met een geweer zo heen en weer de kamer binnenspringen. Godzijdank waren er geen inbrekers. En dit is typisch wat er gebeurt als Redmond in de buurt is.
Redmond is loved by his friends because he's a fantasist. And I think And the travel is completely irrelevant to his writing. And one of these days he'll discover that he can stay at home, write a book, and then go away for a holiday in the jungle. And enjoy himself and do those things he likes, like having leeches in his underpants and having to climb into wet clothes to go to bed, or whatever he does that gives him so much pleasure, without having to come home and sob and weep and go running in the woods nearby when he can't write it.
You're preparing now your third book, and it's also a travel book.
Yes.
And everybody is asking you, I think, when are you preparing a novel?
Well,
Could you write a novel?
Which I have written a novel.
Can you write? Yeah.
But it wasn't the reviews, and it was never published, but there was a report about it, and I was thrown out of Oxford as a student for writing a dirty novel. It's about Wiltshire. It wasn't very dirty, but that was enough.
You're preparing your third novel and your third travel book. And after that, there's become a fourth, I think. It's on Oceania or Australia.
Yes, on what? New Guinea, I think.
New Guinea.
I'd like to, if I'm still young enough, I'd like to start on the south coast and try and walk right across the island.
And after that?
After that, I can, I'll be an old man by then, I should think. And I can come to Amsterdam and write about that.
No poems, yeah.
I'll write about old Badawin and his library, hobbling about on his library set.
I made that in 1988.